Hello, I am Tyagarajan. In this video, I am going to explain how to prepare for answering multiple choice questions in computer architecture and organization. I also give short explanation for each topic related to the questions asked. This will help to have a better understanding of the questions asked and the answers given. Since this is a core subject for many undergraduate engineering courses, I have prepared a series of videos in this subject for the benefit of students. I have given the links for the PPTs in the description, which will be not only useful to the students, but also the faculty members who are handling the subject computer architecture and organization. If you are new to my YouTube channel and want to receive all the videos I am posting in computer and electronic subjects, research and project ideas, please press subscribe button and also the bell icon. If you like this video, please press the like button and also share the link with your friends, students and also faculty members. When you start the subject computer architecture and organization, the first question that arises is, what is the difference between the computer architecture and computer organization? The computer architecture deals with the way of designing the computer components. That is, how to design ALU, how to design the control unit, how to design the registers used in the CPU, how to design the instruction set and the addressing modes. All these things are discussed under computer architecture. But computer organization deals with the structural relationship between these components. That is, where to place which component. For example, if you are using a cache in your computer system, where to place that cache? Cache may be placed within the CPU, or it may be placed between CPU and memory. So where to place? How to connect that cache with the memory or CPU? How to connect the segments of the networks in the computer system? How to connect many processes together to form the network? So all these things are discussed under computer organization. So computer architecture deals with the design of the components, but computer organization deals how to connect these components, what hierarchy should be followed, what is the structural relationship to be followed, and how to improve the performance by connecting these components. All these things will be discussed in computer organization. In any computer system, high-level language instructions are translated to assembly language, and these assembly instructions are translated to machine codes by compiler and assembler software. Actually, the compiler translates high-level language to machine code. The assembler translates the assembly language to machine code. So these software, that is compiler and assembler, are called as system level software. The assembly language instruction set and addressing modes depend on the architecture of the computer system. Instruction format and addressing modes help to translate assembly language to machine language. Now, with this background, let us try to answer some of the multiple choice questions. The first question is, computer architecture explains the way of designing the computer hardware. Yes, it is correct. The functions of each component, it is also correct. The registers, instruction set and addressing modes, this is also correct. So all the above. So D is the right answer. The second question is, computer organization explains the way of connecting the components of the computer systems, the structural relationship between the system components and their interconnections. Both are correct. Segments of networks in a computer system and its performance. This is also correct. So all the above. So the answer is D, all the above. Now let us see the next question. Compiler is A, an application software, B, an operating system, C, a system software, D, a program editing software. So I have already told that compiler and assemblers are system software. So C is the correct answer. The next question is, assembly languages are specific to compiler, B, operating system, C, hardware, D, instruction set architecture. So here, assembly languages are specific to the instruction set. For each processor, we will have a different assembly language and we will have different instruction set. So D is the correct answer. Now, let us see the components of a computer system. This figure shows a computer system. It has a central processing unit, this block, and it has a memory unit. It has input devices and output devices. The central processing unit has a control unit and arithmetic logic unit. The main function of the control unit is to fetch the instruction from the main memory, identify the operation and devices involved in it. It produces the control and timing signals which are required to execute the operation. The instruction is executed in the arithmetic logic unit, ALU. The ALU will be able to do the basic arithmetic and logical operations. For example, adding two numbers, multiplying the numbers, subtracting the numbers, then some logical functions AND, OR, not like that. So the arithmetic and logical functions are executed in this ALU. Then this is the main memory. Between this main memory and CPU, a high-speed small memory will be put. That is called as cache. Cache will increase the execution speed. It is acting as a buffer between the main memory and the CPU. We are using MIPS microprocessor architecture. The expansion for MIPS is microprocessor without pipeline stages. MIPS is a 32-bit microprocessor architecture. MIPS is also a RISC architecture. RISC means reduced instruction set computer. Generally, any microprocessor architecture will have a program counter which holds the address of the current instruction being executed. It is also called as instruction pointer. See, in some architecture, it will be called as program counter. In some other architectures, it will be called as instruction pointer. But whatever may be the case, it will hold the address of the current instruction. Now, based on this information, let us try to answer for some multiple choice questions. The first question is this one. An N-bit microprocessor has N-bit instruction pointer, that is program counter, N-bit data register. Any microprocessor will have registers internally. N-bit ALU, all the above. For example, in MIPS architecture, it is a 32-bit microprocessor. So, the instruction pointer size is 32-bit, then ALU size is 32-bit, the registers size is also 32-bit. So, if all these are 32 bits, then the microprocessor is a 32-bit processor. So, here the answer is all the above, that is A, B, C, all are true for this. Now, let us see the next question. Actual execution in a computer takes place in registers, ALU, control unit, instruction register. Actually, the instruction register will decode the instruction, it will understand the instruction, and control unit will generate timing and control signals. The registers will hold the data values, and only ALU will be executing instructions. For example, AND or all these operations will be executed in ALU. So, answer is B. Now, let us see the third question. Program counter is also called as instruction counter. A is instruction counter, B is address pointer, C is instruction pointer, D is memory pointer. Actually, the program counter is having the address of the current instruction being executed. That means it gives the address, but it is not counting the address. It is just pointing the address. So, the correct answer is C, that is instruction pointer. You may be tempted to choose A, instruction counter. It is not like that. It is only pointing the memory location, so it is instruction pointer. So, C is the correct answer. Now, let us see the fourth question. The address of the current instruction being executed is in A, memory, B, accumulator, C, program counter, D, cache register. So, the program counter is the correct answer. C is the correct answer. Now, let us see the next question. The function of a control unit in a CPU is to decode program instructions, to perform logic operations, to store program instructions, to transfer data to primary storage. So, the control unit is not only generating timing and control signals. It will be able to generate those things only after decoding the instruction. That is, after identifying the instruction. So, the control unit is also decoding the instruction and then it generates the necessary control signals. So, A is correct. So, let us see the next one. A processor has 3 GHz clock rate and a CPI of 1.5. How many clock cycles will be used by this processor when it executes a program in 10 seconds? Now, 3 GHz clock rate means it has 3 into 10 power 9 clock cycles per second. Clock rate means per second. So, 3 into 10 power 9 cycles per second. Giga means 10 power 9. CPI indicates the number of cycles per instruction. So, how many cycles an instruction requires for execution? That is given as CPI. It is 1.5. And the program takes 10 seconds for execution. What is asked? How many cycles will be used? Actually, for 1 second, there will be 3 into 10 power 9 cycles. That is clock rate. So, if it takes 10 seconds, then 3 into 10 power 9 into 10, those many cycles will be required. The CPI is not necessary in this problem. Only to confuse you, they have given this one. So the answer will be 3 into 10 power 9 into 10. Let us see the options. 3 into 10 power 9 into 1.5 into 10. This is not correct. 3 into 10 power 9 into 10. This is correct. B is correct. 3 into 10 power 9 into 10 divided by 1.5. Actually, 1.5 is not at all needed here. So if it is introduced in the answer, it is wrong. In all cases, all other three cases, 1.5 is included. So the correct answer is B. 3 into 10 power 9 into 10. Now let us see another question. A processor has 3 GHz clock rate and a CPI of 1.5. The same problem given in the previous slide. Values are same, but the problem is different. If this processor executes a program in 10 seconds, after this, both are same. But what is required? How many instructions will be in that program? In this case, you should know this CPI. So one instruction requires 1.5 clock cycles. So within 10 seconds, you will have 3 into 10 power 9 into 10 cycles. Now, if you need the number of instructions, 3 into 10 power 9 into 10 divided by 1.5 will give the number of instructions. Let us see. So 3 into 10 power 9 into 1.5 into 10, that is option A. Actually, it is not correct because 1.5 should come in the denominator. Then only you will get the number of instructions. So this is also not correct. Here, you see 3 into 10 power 9 into 10, this will give the total number of cycles. Then per instruction, you need 1.5 cycles. So if you divide this by 1.5, you will get the number of instructions. So C is the right answer. So D, it is wrong. The formula is like this. Even you need not remember the formula. If you have a basic understanding, you will be able to do directly. Anyway, if you want to remember the formula, you can remember. Number of instructions is equal to clock rate into number of seconds divided by CPI. Now, see the answer. It is C. That is, it should be divided by 1.5. The total number of cycles used for 10 seconds should be divided by 1.5. That will give the number of instructions executed within that 10 seconds.